Mr. Gurumurthy, distinguished members of VIF, ladies and gentlemen, I'm grateful to VIF for this opportunity to be here following a very erudite lecture by Sri Gurumurthy. So let me actually take off from where he ended, in a sense, that one of the defining features of India's economic policy over the last couple of decades has been a rediscovery of its place in the international economy. For almost 40 years after independence from 1947 till the late 80s, like many other developing countries, we pursued an inward-looking model of economic development, very protectionist. Our share of world trade, which is actually around 2% in 1947, came down to 0.5% in the 60s and remained there till the 1990s. We reduced our share of world trade. We forgot our external economic links with the world around us. India for centuries was at the center of trade between Asia to our east and Asia to our west. We have historical evidence of lot of these linkages, but all of that was forgotten in a period in which we imitated many other developing countries and followed what we call an inward-looking model of economic development. That changed with the end of the Cold War in 1991 as India began to reassess its relations with the world. And among the books that I've written that was mentioned, I always recommended my own favorite book of mine, which is called 1991. It's an assessment of what happened in that particular year, linking changes in our economic policy to changes in the global system, the end of the Cold War, and the paradigm shift that happened. So from 91, there's a shift in the way in which we began to imagine our economic policy. And I relate this to what Mr. Gurumurthy just said in his speech earlier this morning, because it also coincided with a rediscovery of our civilizational links with East Asia, with West Asia. Prime Minister Narasimha Rao launched what was called the Look East policy, which strengthened our economic interaction with ASEAN, with Japan, Korea, Taiwan, and now after a certain point even with China, because of which before 1991 more than half of our trade and economic links were with India to our west. After 2000, more than half of our economic links are now to with India to our east, and this shift of the balance of the Indian economy's external linkages from the west to the east is really linked to a rediscovery of our links with Asia that has happened in the last few decades. Many of you may be familiar with the work of Angus Maddison, a historian, a Cambridge historian, who was commissioned by the Organization of Economic Cooperation and Development, OECD, to undertake a survey of the global economy. It began essentially as a survey of the global economy over a 100-year period and ended up as a survey of the global economy over a 1,000-year period. And if you look at the data that Angus Maddison and his team have been able to put together, the striking aspect of this study was that from 1000 AD till 1700 AD, for the first 700 years, China and India contributed to almost 50% of world income, the two economies together, more or less equal. 25% each, roughly, and that it is only after 1700 that Europe began to increase its share of world income, and the share of China's and India's share declined sharply, so that by 1950, China's share of world income was 5%, India's share was 3%, and that of Europe was around 26%, and of course North America was another. So US and North America and Western Europe became the dominant economies of the world in the 20th century, just as China and India were the dominant economies of the world in the period before the 17th century. That constitutes the background to the way in which we now look at our own role in the world. India seeks to increase its share of world income, it seeks to increase its share of world trade, it seeks to increase the participation through investment flows, etc. And I think there is therefore a very interesting link one can draw between the changing perception of the country in the framework within which Mr. Gurumurthy spoke and the changing focus of our own economic policy. Let me bring you to the present. The latest data we have from the World Bank shows that in the year 2018, the Indian economy was the fifth largest, in 2019, the Indian economy was the fifth largest with 2.9 trillion dollars. The United States being the largest economy, China being the second largest. And there have been many forecast projections for the next several years, which suggest that whether we reach 5 trillion or not by 2024, there's an argument going on among economists on what it will take for us to become a $5 trillion economy by 2024, which is, as you know, the kind of agenda set by the Prime Minister. But whether that happens or not, depending on the rates of growth we are able to achieve in the next few years. The fact is that we are set to overtake both Germany and Japan. We are set to overtake Germany first in terms of the share of world income, and emerge as the fourth largest, and possibly in some period of time become the third largest. So I think most people who look at the world economy in the 21st century have come to the understanding that certainly by 2030, if not earlier, but certainly by 2030, the three dominant world economies would be the United States, followed by China, and with a distance, India. And how these three countries manage their relations, how they impact the global system, will be the basis on which the international economic system will begin to be defined. Now, given this kind of objective, given this hope that India has of emerging as the third largest economy in the world in the foreseeable future, what has been our track record, which is what I'll talk about, and then come to some of the issues that we face right now this year as we go forward. This chart shows you the rise of the Indian economy from 1960 onwards, and you'll see that the real kind of acceleration of growth begins after our economic reforms of 1991, but more significantly after the turn of the century. So it's really in the last 20 years that you see accelerated pace of growth of the economy. And this has been contributed by three very different factors. First and foremost, the share of investment in national income, which was below 20% for a long time, went into the 20s during the 1990s. And after 2000, the share of gross investment in national income went up to 30%. And in fact, it peaked from 30, it went up to 35% in the year 2010. The high growth years were from 2003 to 2012. Those 6 years were really, those 8 years from 2003 to around 2011 were the high growth years for the Indian economy, where the growth rate was actually above 8%. And that was largely on account of an increase in the share of investment in national income, following very much the trajectory that all the East Asian economies took. If you look at the so-called Asian tigers, the East Asian model, all of them were able to accelerate growth by increasing share of investment in national income. Of course, many of them, including China, have a share of investment of as high as 40%. We have not been able to move that fast, but we have certainly moved from the 20s into the 30s. The problem for the Indian economy, as I'll show you in a little later, in the recent past, has been a decline in the share, and therefore the policy objective at the moment is, in fact, to once again restore the momentum for investment. But the second factor that triggered this growth process was the external economic liberalization. India's share of world trade has started going up. It went down, as I said, to as low as 0.5% before the reforms of 91, and slowly crawling up to now around merchandise trade to about 1.5%. And if you include services trade, our share of world trade is now closer to around between 2.5 to 3%, which of course is nowhere near where China has been able to, which also saw its share of world trade go down to 0.5% at the time of China's independence, at the time of the Communist Revolution. But China now has about 12 to 15%, I forget the exact number, but you know, in double digits, share of world trade. So trade, increasing trade, and share of trade in India's national income has sharply gone up. Now it's close to 50%, while before 91, it was well below 25%. So investment increase, trade increase, and the third factor that has contributed to this rise of growth was, of course, productivity increase. With an increasingly talented workforce, productivity rates, particularly in agriculture, but also in manufacturing, have gone up. What is interesting as far as the growth process is concerned is that, you know, in the era when rates of growth were low, we had very high rates of inflation. But in the era in which rates of growth have actually gone up, our rates of inflation have come down. So the average rate of inflation for India from 1950 to 1990, for 40 years, if we take the data, the average rate of inflation was about 8%. But we've had episodic, very high rates of inflation. Nothing like Latin America. We have never had, I think, the highest rate of inflation. If you just take 1 year, we probably had in one particular year about, you know, you can see that spike, more than 25% rate of inflation, but that's only 1 year. But even if you take high inflation years, high inflation in India was always what we used to call in the media double-digit inflation. Wherever it crossed 10%, the media would kind of start making a big noise. There would be a lot of demonstrations and protests, and the government policy would then have to take into account the response and cut down through fiscal and monetary intervention. So the overall Indian experience with inflation, unlike other developing countries, has been a fairly positive experience. But in the recent past, we've seen inflation rate coming down sharply. The Monetary Policy Committee, in fact, has targeted 3 to 5% range of inflation. Though personally, I think this is a very conservative rate. I don't know whether Mr. Gurumurthy agrees with me, but I think a developing country like India should not accept such a low rate of inflation. I have always argued in favor of rate of inflation closer to the long-term average, which is 8%. If you get 6% growth, 6% inflation, then your nominal GDP is 12%. Last year, our nominal GDP was 7.5%, which is unacceptable, because the growth was about 4% and inflation was about 3.5%, and we get a nominal rate of growth of 7.5%. This year's budget, the finance minister has said the nominal rate of growth would be 10%, though she doesn't tell us how it's going to be split. But the economic survey suggests that the growth rate may be 6, in which case we are talking of a 4% inflation rate. I don't think that's really something we should celebrate. I would rather have a slightly higher rate of inflation and go for a nominal growth rate of 12% and move towards a nominal rate of growth of around 12 to 14% as a medium-term objective if we really want the economy to become a $5 trillion economy by 2024. I mentioned this sharp fall in investment. Those figures, if they are clear to you at the back, will show that gross fixed capital formation went down sharply in the last 5 years. This data is from the year 2011 to 2017-18. So you can see a sharp decline led mainly by the household sector. Household investment, household savings have gone down. And there are several explanations as to why this has happened. But the fact is that this decline in the investment rate has impacted GDP. One of the major concerns of the current government, as well as incidentally of the previous government, has been to increase the share of manufacturing in national income. Many of you have heard of the Make in India program. The origins of the Make in India program actually go back to a document called the National Strategy of Manufacturing that was written in 2006 when Manmohan Singh was the Prime Minister. And basically what that document said was that India's, the share of manufacturing in India is far too low. Look at the rest of East Asia, look at China, all of them have much higher rates of, much higher shares of manufacturing. And that India's share of manufacturing in India was only around 16%. I'm talking the early part of the century, 2006. And it set an objective. In 2006, the National Strategy of Manufacturing set the objective of raising the share of manufacturing from 16% of GDP to 20% by the year 2020. And we are already in the year 2020. And we have not achieved that objective. The share of manufacturing remains around 16%. We have just not been able to push it. Both the previous government and the present government have tried to do this through what is called a Make in India program. But there are several impediments, and I think the biggest impediment remains the unease of doing business in this country. I've been Secretary General of FICCI, which is an organization of Indian business, and I can tell you Indian businessmen are more worried than any other businessman from anywhere in the world, that it's just not yet easy to do business in India, and therefore we constantly put pressure on government, both at the center and in the states, to make it easier for people to invest in this country and to make it easier for manufacturers to manufacture in this country. And that pressure will remain because we cannot accept, as a developing country with a large unskilled labor force, a large youth force, we cannot simply accept such a low rate of share of manufacturing in GDP. And you know, while this increase is impressive in the recent past, what should worry us is the last leg of this bottom curve, the decline in the share in GDP in the last few years. And this has to be reversed. This has to be, in my judgment, the single most important for economic policy objective of the government. Then nothing else matters. You can accept a higher rate of inflation. You can accept a higher rate of fiscal deficit. Nothing else. You can open up the economy much more. I don't care what else we do. But to reverse this trend is, in my judgment, the biggest challenge for India. We cannot, you know, this mythology that has been spread by many people that India can jump the manufacturing stage and remain a services-led economy, that services growth alone can sustain the rate of growth and provide adequate jobs. I think I don't believe in that myth. I'm a manufacturing first guy. And the challenge for manufacturing is only increasing with automation, with robotization, with artificial intelligence, with 3D printing. All of these are challenges. But despite these challenges, there is I believe this remains a major. And here, the fact is that at the end of the day, it's what state governments do that makes more difference, because you know industry is set in a particular part of the country, not in India in a kind of a abstract sense. You set up businesses in some part of the country, and therefore what local governments do. And you can see that the states which were industrial states in the 1960s remain the industrial states today. The only exception is 100 kilometers around New Delhi. You know, whether you go towards Jaipur or you go towards Chandigarh, you go towards Aligarh, or you drive any direction out of Delhi for 100 kilometers, you see industrial development. But that's the only change that has happened in this country in the last 50 years. Otherwise, Gujarat, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, and now Telangana have remained the industrial states of the country. They've always been the industrial states. Bengal used to be an industrial state, but Bengal's share has gone down. There is some recovery of space by Bengal in the recent past, but peninsular India remains the industrial part of India. Northern India has more or less abdicated that role, and recovering space for industrial development is, in my judgment, a major challenge that India faces. Let us move on to the external sector. I told you that globalization and external liberalization has been an important driver for India's economic development, which is why if you see the speeches of Prime Minister Modi, for all the talk we hear about nationalism, I think on the economy, he is a globalizer. His speech at the Davos last year more or less echoed the views of President Xi Jinping of China. Unlike the US president, who is a protectionist, who says America first, and unlike many European countries which are becoming protectionist, India, though it has increased import duties in the recent past, mainly to deal with the problem of inadequate export growth, remains committed to increasing share of trade in national income. And that's because for two important reasons, which have defined external trade policy. First and foremost is that on a per capita basis, we are a resources deficient country. We are dependent on the world for oil. We are dependent on the world for energy. We are dependent on the world for minerals. We are dependent on the world. We become dependent every now and then, even for food, though in the several years we have not had to import food, but every now and then there is some commodity spike, whether it's onions or sugar or whatever. So we have certain dependencies driven by population on the external world. And our trade policy is essentially aimed at ensuring that we are able to finance these dependencies. To a large extent, because of the low share of merchandise trade in total trade, we have financed this through services exports. And therefore, remittances of Indians working in the Gulf are an important component of our foreign exchange inflows. Remittances by Indians working in the rest of the world economy or export of services to the developed economies becomes an important income. But the global system does not have a neutral regime for services. This has been one of our demands in the WTO. It's been one of our demands in regional trade discussions like the RCEP, etc. There's not just rules for merchandise trade, but you need rules for services trade, because at the end of the day, whether it's a product goes out in the form of a physical, tangible good, or in the form of ideas, in the form of services, it's an export of human labor that is happening. It takes different forms. But we have disciplines for merchandise trade, you have disciplines for investment inflow, but we don't have disciplines for services trade. And that is why India keeps demanding, and we decided to stay off the RCEP negotiations because of the refusal of those countries to include a services trade in that. But having said all that, I think the popular image abroad, particularly in the West, that India is a closed economy, is simply not true if you look at the share of external trade in GDP, which has sharply increased in the it has come down, as I said, everything has come down in the last 5-6 years. I mean, the last 5-6 years have not been particularly good for the Indian economy. And I think the focus of policy today is to really go back to this medium-term growth path. But overall, if you see over the last couple of decades, the share of trade in GDP has gone up. In response to the criticism that this government has been increasing tariffs, as I said, some of those are episodic. It is meant to deal with a sudden fall in exports, a rise in trade deficit, etc. But average trade-weighted average tariff rate has again come down. I mean, sharply came down after liberalization in the 90s, but it has remained steady. So the spike that you may have read about in the media in this budget or even in the previous budget is only a minor twist up in that declining curve. The more ideologically oriented free trade economists like Arvind Panagaria, who used to be a former chairman of Niti Aayog, they all get very upset about this. But I'm not so worried. I think the and I can be very honest and say that when I was Secretary General of FICCI, this is one of our demands we were making as a business organization, that India is facing unfair competition, particularly from China, and the huge trade deficit that India has with China is a problem for Indian business, is a problem for Indian manufacturing. And you know, while we are negotiating with China to increase you know, their imports in a range of commodities where India has a comparative advantage or competitive advantage, but where there are a lot of non-tariff barriers, whether it's in food exports, agricultural exports, pharmaceutical exports, many of these you know, areas, it's not easy for Indian companies to export to China. So we are negotiating with the Chinese to become more open to Indian exports. But in the meanwhile, to deal with this surge of imports from China, the government has had to increase tariffs, and also to deal with the trade protectionism of the United States. The US, the world's richest economy, has high tariffs for Indian exports. I mean, a reference was made to my column this morning. It's unacceptable, for me at least, that a country with a per capita GDP of $60,000 should regard India, whose per capita GDP is $2,000, as a developed economy, and treat us as a developed economy for all tariff purposes, which is what the US has done by withdrawing the GSP. We are a developing country. By no stretch of imagination adopting any unfair trade practices. We are members of the World Trade Organization. We adhere to all the disciplines of the World Trade Organization. If you are not happy with what we are doing, you can take us to the WTO. But you can't simply take unilateral decisions based on the presumption, oh, that you have now become developed. So I think that trade action by President Trump is something which I completely disapprove of. And I don't expect too much out of the Trump visit for that reason. Moving beyond trade, FDI inflows have gone up. And this is one area in which policy has been further liberalized in the recent past. But as I said earlier, while a lot of this is coming in acquisitions or in businesses where there is very little of greenfield manufacturing capacity being generated. So you have an IKEA coming, which is bringing in products from outside and selling to an Indian market. You have Amazon coming in, which is basically facilitating the sale of products either manufactured outside the country or within the country. But greenfield projects, new companies which produce new products and export out of India, that is not happening on the scale on which it ought to. And whatever good is happening is again happening in four or five states, Gujarat, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, beyond that, and of course, around Delhi. But beyond that, we do not see enough of export-oriented manufacture coming out of FDI inflows. So while we celebrate higher FDI inflows, I think the message I would have for foreign investors or for countries around the world is export out of India. You know, that is what will help you in promoting business in India. If you're simply coming here to sell to the Indian market and thereby displace an Indian producer out of the Indian market, bring in foreign brands and displace Indian brands, that is not something that would be acceptable to Indian manufacturers, at least. It may be acceptable to a kind of elite consuming class, but certainly not to the manufacturing sector of the economy. Well, this is the what I was telling you, the regional spread. All the numbers about India are really averages for a fairly widespread difference in the performance of different parts of the country. Gujarat, Haryana, Andhra Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh. Madhya Pradesh has done reasonably well, mainly because of Indore's proximity to Mumbai and a lot of industrial development around Indore and the NCR region of Delhi. Haryana again is the NCR region of Delhi. So among the top four performers are two coastal states, Gujarat and Andhra Pradesh, and the NCR region. These are followed by Odisha, Uttarakhand, Telangana. These are growth rates. So in some cases, the base would be very low. Uttarakhand would have a low base. Assam would have a low base. But Maharashtra, Gujarat would be high growth rates on a high base. Tamil Nadu, again, high base, high growth rate. Rajasthan, Jharkhand, and Bihar and UP have low base, and but recently some improved growth rates. Punjab, Jammu and Kashmir, West Bengal, and Chhattisgarh remain, of course, below 6%. So these are fairly diverse data for the last 6 years. But this diversity, as I said, is virtually a 100-year diversity. If you look at data from 1900 to now, more or less the same pattern projects itself. Finally, this might interest some of you. That's why I put this slide in. And since I'm now with the Institute for Defense Studies, this is a subject of some interest to me, defense spending. Defense spending has gone up in absolute numbers in the last decade, but as a share of GDP, because of GDP itself has gone up, it has actually come down. I mentioned this, I put this slide in to make the point, which I believe is actually something we have not adequately emphasized in our policy, is that one area where Make in India can really make a difference is defense manufacturing. Our policies, again, have been very, very slow to change. The change started in 2015 when Mr. Arun Jaitley was the finance minister and defense minister in the same year. But the movement has been very slow. Even today, we are hesitant to look at FDI in defense manufacturing. There are all manner of conditionalities, but I think the future for manufacturing, and this is really a message to those of you who come from countries with a defense manufacturing base, that you will see increasingly a preference for domestic manufacturing in defense. We already see in this year's budget a focus on the in this year's Republic Day parade as well. Many of you may have seen the parade, how many of the locally manufactured products were on display by the defense public sector organizations. But I think this is where domestic industry is looking for opportunities. We are the only major power in the world without a sizable domestic defense manufacturing capability. If you look at all the major powers, whether it's United States, Soviet Union, Russia, China, Brazil, Japan, you know, everybody has a large defense industry. Our defense industry is still very small. But this is one area where Make in India can really be pushed. I remember when Nirmala Sitharaman was the defense minister, when we were in Chennai, we talked about a defense corridor from Chennai to Coimbatore, you know, Dindigul, etc. I hope that's going, but we need to push that. And push that in a significant way, allowing FDI. You know, there's a lot of hesitation for 100% FDI in defense. I have no idea why there is. Because if you're buying, importing equipment, it is 100% FDI. It's only the manufacturing somewhere else. The employment is being provided somewhere else. But you allow relocation of that manufacturing base, allow 100% FDI. You don't need technologies, access to technology. You need the weaponry, you need the equipment. But manufacturing here has its externalities. And I think that is one direction I would like to see manufacturing policy go forward. So what are the key policy issues today? As I said, the most important policy issue is really to step up the rate of growth. The long-term rate of growth for the last 75 years, we have 30 years of 3.5% from 1950 to 1980, from 1980 to 2000, 5.5%. From 2000 to 2011-12, around 7.5%. And then we've had a debate over the growth rate over the last few years because of change of definitions and base year, etc. But whatever it is, the growth rate in the last few years has been below 7.5%. And really, we need to go back. The view I've heard from fairly responsible functionaries in the government today is that in the medium term, which is really we're looking at the next 3-4 years, it's reasonable to expect the economy to be in the bandwidth of 6-7%. That's the reasonable bandwidth. very unlikely that we'll cross 7%, very unlikely we'll go below 5%, but certainly 6 to 7 is a reasonable ambition for the economy. And going forward, while increasing the share of manufacturing, of course, will be the challenge. In order to sustain this 6 to 7% growth rate, the policy has to target both the investments and the savings rates. Both these have gone down in the last 5 years, and both these have to be increased in the next 5 years. As I said, I would not worry too much about a fiscal deficit. The tax GDP ratio has to be increased. There is no way in which a country of the size of India can operate with a tax GDP ratio, which I think around 12-13% now, unacceptable. But finally, the four kind of long-term, what I would call structural challenges for the economy are human capital formation, management of urbanization, management of environment, and the management of the regional imbalance. These are the four challenges for policy in the long term. Short-term policy challenges are easier to handle budget to budget, whether it's the savings rate, investment rate, tax rate, fiscal deficit rate, etc., so current account deficit, etc. I have not mentioned current account deficit. We don't have a problem there. That is one of the strengths of the Indian economy. Despite export slowdown, despite the trade deficit, our current account deficit remains very low. I think it's less than 2% of GDP, probably 1.5%, if my memory serves me right. And therefore, it's not really an issue. But these are the four long-term challenges. Human capital formation is the most important challenge. The supply of skilled labor, not at the top of the pyramid, but at the bottom of the pyramid. Our problem with our educational system is that we produce world-class material at the top of the pyramid, and that migrates. It's at the bottom of the pyramid that we are not yet producing world-class material in terms of skilled labor, and which reflects in low labor productivity compared to other East Asian economies. So human capital formation is the most important economic challenge in the medium term. Second is managing urbanization. The range of quality of for living varies all the way from cities which are well managed to cities which are not managed at all. And urbanization is a challenge. Environment and regional imbalance, I mean, I don't have to take your time talking about those. But these remain medium-term challenges. Let me end by saying that the immediate challenge for the country this year is really to ensure a unleashing of what I call animal spirits. Getting private investment back into the market, getting investors to invest and to put their money where their mouth is. There has been a lot of hesitation. The banks were not willing to lend, investors are not willing to invest. This holding back is a psychological problem. It is not a fiscal problem. It is not a cash problem. There is enough cash in the system. Companies do not have a balance sheet problem. You know, we keep reading a lot about NPAs. Yeah, there are a lot of companies which are burdened with non-performing assets. But a large part of Indian economy, large part of Indian business has the money. The problem is they're not spending it. Many households have the money. The problem is they're not spending it. And the reason for that is that we have lived through a period of negative expectations. And I'm an old-fashioned Keynesian. I've been trained in Keynesian economics. I have no apology for remaining old-fashioned in my views. And one of the most important lessons that we all learned from Keynes is expectations have a way of getting fulfilled. You expect tomorrow to be good, tomorrow will be good. You expect tomorrow to be bad, tomorrow will be bad. Because expectations define behavior. And the expectation of investors, the expectation of households has been bearish. And you need a recognition of that. You need a recognition and you need a policy that addresses those expectations, that tells people that tomorrow will be better than today. for specific reasons, not simply a kind of a blanket slogan that, you know, we will be a great economy, but in specific numbers, etc., to show that demand will once again recover. Jobs will once again be forthcoming. Employment will be more long-lasting and not episodic. It is those expectations that drove the growth process from 2003 to 2012. That 9-year period was driven by positive expectations. The problem with that period was that expectations were too optimistic, and therefore investments were made based on excessive optimism. As for example, civil aviation. Too much capacity was built, and the companies were not able to survive excess capacity. We found that in telecom, you know, many industries where the expectation was over-optimistic, and the adjustment has happened over the last 5-6 years. But today we are in a cycle where expectations are over-pessimistic. And therefore, altering the state of expectations to say that no, tomorrow will not be like yesterday. That yesterday, yes, we had 4.8% growth, below 5% growth, but things will improve, and this is the policy management that I'm hoping we will see more of as we go through this year. Let me stop with that. I'll be happy to take questions.